Hello and welcome back to the Wasteland, everybody. Welcome back to Fallout New Vegas, where today we're going to be taking a look at the 9mm SMG, the grease gun. Even though real-life grease guns are usually not 9mm, they're usually 45, but that doesn't matter. At least it's a real gun, which is more than what you can say about some of the other Fallout games. So the 9mm submachine gun can be the very first submachine gun that you find. It likely will be, because there is one hidden. Well, it's not really hidden. There's one that is broken in Doc Mitchell's house, and if you have 25 repair, then you can repair that submachine gun and you can carry it around with you, which is really, really awesome. So for the base stats of the 9mm SMG, this one requires 25 guns and 3 strength wield. This is actually the very first gun that we're going to be talking about on this series that has a guns requirement, although 25 guns is very low. 3 strength is also very low. I feel like most characters are going to have at least 3 strength, so basically anybody's going to be able to use this right at the very start or very soon into the very start, assuming that you are going for a guns build and you're not building towards energy weapons or explosives or something very specific. This one does 14 damage per shot, which is pretty decent for a submachine gun, especially a 9mm submachine gun. This one does 154 damage per second, which is extremely high, and these are all just the base damage stats. These are not modified damage stats based on perks. And the 9mm submachine gun does have one really, really good perk that I would recommend if you're going to be using this. This one does 14 crit damage, which is fine. It's the same as its base damage, which is okay. Although its crit chance is extremely low. Most automatic weapons tend to have really low crit chance. This one has a 0.06 times chance of critting. So it is very low. You're probably not going to crit super often with this. And honestly, weapons like this don't really need to rely on crits anyway, but it is kind of cool when you do roll crits for them. And they can still hit sneak crits, since they do have a crit modifier of some sort, and a sneak crit will do double the crit damage, which is kind of nice. This one costs 20 action points per burst. This one doesn't fire one round at every time you use the VAT system. It actually fires out 3 rounds, so it's a 3 round burst, which is fine. It's actually pretty decent for the action point cost. And this one has pretty decent spread. Most of the automatic weapons like this have pretty decent spread. This isn't one of the least accurate submachine guns or least accurate full auto weapons, but it's also not one of the most accurate. It's kind of in the middle for terms of accuracy, which is okay. You're probably not going to be using this at very long range. This one has a 30 round magazine in it by default, which is pretty good. And then this one weighs 4 weight, so it's not super heavy either. This also has 550 item health. Most automatic weapons tend to have a lot of health, which is decent enough. You're not going to break these things super fast. And they are at least common enough in the early game to where you can repair them decently often. For the basic pros of the 9mm submachine gun, this one does have a really high rate of fire, which can be very good against certain enemy types, and it makes it so your DPS is also quite high. This one also has a large magazine. Holding 30 rounds is really good in the early game. It can actually be buffed up even further with the mods. We'll talk about that in a second, which is good. And it has pretty cheap ammo and fairly common ammo. A lot of enemies in the early game tend to have 9mm. Basically, every merchant is going to sell 9mm in some capacity. So stocking up on ammo is not super difficult for this, and it does actually have a couple different ammo types, which we'll talk about after we get through with the cons. But the major cons of this weapon is that it does do low damage per shot, and it sort of lacks in terms of ammo variety. This is only really bad if you're talking about armored enemies. The 9mm submachine gun doesn't do very well against armored enemies because a lot of their armor can eat through the damage and you won't be doing nearly as much damage to them, and you don't really have a great way of piercing through armor with this. So it's going to struggle against things like rad scorpions or against heavily armored NPCs, but against non-armored enemies it can just shred right through them, which is really cool. For the ammos that the 9mm submachine gun has access to, it has the standard 9mm, which is just the base stats of the weapon, so that's perfectly fine. It has the 9mm plus P, which does actually have some armor piercing to it. It actually gives you a 10% damage buff when using this. It punches through 2 points of armor, but it does break your weapon 20% faster, which isn't such a huge deal, but you're probably not going to be able to find a whole lot of this. But if you do want to fight something with armor, this one is technically the best option for the 9mm. Then you also have the 9mm hollow points, which will get you 75% more damage, but they give the enemy 3 times the amount of armor, so it's really bad against armored enemies, but really good against non-armored enemies. And then there is also the jacketed hollow points, which you can make with the perk hand loader. This one gives you 65% bonus damage, and it makes some enemies have 2 times armor. So it's a little bit better than the hollow point rounds, at least if you're going to be using it for slightly more armored enemies. It's not really that much weaker than regular hollow points. Regular hollow points will technically get you the most amount of damage, but I don't know if that's super necessary with the 9mm submachine gun. I would say that the jacketed hollow points are the ones that I use the most often, but I tend to be using this against light armored enemies most of the time. Now, there is one perk in particular that does need to be mentioned with the 9mm submachine gun, and that perk is Grunt. Grunt is amazing for this weapon. It's an amazing perk in general, but this will get you an additional 25% more damage with the 9mm submachine gun. So if you plan on using this weapon, or if you use this weapon and you're like, I really enjoy this weapon, I want it to be stronger, you can absolutely do that and make the 9mm submachine gun way stronger than it otherwise would be, which is really cool. If you do that, then the damage would go from 14 base damage up to 20 damage, at least if you're going with all damage perks. This would also include things like Bloody Mess. And your DPS actually doubles from this, going from 154 all the way up to 310, which is pretty crazy. That's actually a really big buff. And with all of these, assuming that the 9mm is at its strongest, I would actually put the 9mm submachine gun up into our B tier on our T list. It's actually quite good. Now, there is actually a modified version, and we do need to talk about that too. This one can have two mods. The 9mm submachine gun can have a drum magazine, and it can have a lighter bolt. Both of these you're going to have to buy from different vendors. You might have to buy these from the gun runners. There's a couple other vendors that do sell them. There's maybe five or six of them that sell them. They don't seem to be super uncommon, but they're not super common either. Usually I find like one at one vendor and one at another vendor, or I can only find one part of it at a particular vendor and I can't find any more parts, so I'll have to wait like another couple days so that I can look at vendors again and try to find this. But the drum magazine ups your magazine size from 30 rounds up to 60 rounds, which does help quite a bit. That actually makes it so sustained fire is really good, and holding 60 rounds feels really nice in a weapon like this. It's not entirely necessary, because most of the time, at least for me, I'm going to be using this towards things like Kazdors, so I can quickly spray them down. And 30 rounds is usually enough, but 60 rounds makes it so it's even more consistent if there happens to be multiple Kazdors. And then the light bolt makes it so you get a 30% increase to rate of fire, which also helps with that rate of fire stat that we talked about a little bit ago with the DPS being so dang high. 30% more rate of fire is awesome on a submachine gun like this, because again, you're probably going to be using this at close to medium range. I wouldn't actually move up the modded version of the 9mm submachine gun any. I would just put it higher up into B tier, where the regular submachine gun is probably like mid to low B tier. The modified version is probably high B tier. It is a very good weapon. It can be really nice for the early game, assuming that you don't eat through all of your bullets and you can at least keep getting bullets. It's actually quite nice. And then there is one unique version of the 9mm submachine gun we need to talk about too. That is called Vance's SMG. This one you first get hints at when you go to Prim, and it's known that the submachine gun that was used by two gangsters was stolen, and you do have to go up to northern New Vegas. Just above New Vegas, you can find a small shack there where you'll find the people that stole Vance's 9mm submachine gun. You can either break into the safe by having 100 lockpicking in order to get to it, or you can pass a speech check, which I believe is 55 speech, and then you can get Vance's submachine gun there. This one has similar stats to the regular 9mm submachine gun, but just a little bit better. So this one has also 25 guns and 3 strength requirement. This one does 17 damage per shot rather than the 14 damage. This one has higher DPS because of that, coming in at 221. This will be upped even further if you go with Grunt and everything else. This one also already has the mods attached to it, which is really good. So this one does 17 crit damage, has an actually lower crit chance at 0.05 times, so you're even less likely to hit crits with it. Not that that really matters. Also costs 20 action points to use, has the same spread pattern, has a 60 round magazine because this one already has the drum magazine in it, weighs 4, and has 750 health, making it have even higher health than a standard one. This one also uniquely has different sights than the regular 9mm submachine gun, where the 9mm has the aperture sight, the little peep sight in the back. This one has a much more open sight, which I enjoy a whole lot more. It's a lot easier to use, and this one comes with all the same pros and cons of the regular 9mm, but which is more damage, more health, and already decked out and better sights in my opinion. So if you want to take this, you throw the grunt perk on there, then this one goes up to a whopping 445 damage per second, which is really, really high. That is really high, especially for a really common round like this one. It'll serve you really well, and I would put Vance's 9mm submachine gun a tier higher than the regular one, putting it up into A tier. It is a very solid weapon all the way around. Still kind of struggles against armored enemies, but that's really its only like fault. And that's more of a problem with the ammo than the gun itself. If this had armor piercing rounds, then it would be an easy ass tier. So should you use the 9mm submachine gun in New Vegas? Sure, it's actually quite good. As long as you have bullets for it, it's really good in the early game. It can be really solid in the mid game, and it can be pretty decent in the late game too. It does kind of fall off compared to submachine guns, but I know plenty of people that will carry around Vance's submachine gun for the entire game. You can actually run and get it fairly early if you know where it is. and it will serve you quite well. 9mm are fairly common to find around. Most enemies in the early game have them, and if you have something like Vance's SMG, you can just mow through quite a few things pretty early on and not have too much trouble. Today we're going to be taking a look at the 10mm SMG, and we're going to be talking about its pros and its cons, as well as all the strengths that come with it. So the 10mm SMG is probably going to be one of the first submachine guns that you find. You'll likely find the 9mm before this, but this might be like the second or third one that you do find out of all the submachine guns. You're going to find it probably towards the mid game. Certain enemy types can have this, various raiders can have this, as well as the fiends can potentially have this, and you can buy this from quite a few different vendors. This is one of the few weapons that actually fires the 10mm round, which is a fairly common round, but there's not a whole lot of weapons that actually use it. It's just this one, the pistol, and the shoulder-mounted machine gun, and that's it. There's no other competition for this round. The 10mm SMG requires 50 guns in order to wield and 5 strength, so average guns, average strength, pretty normal for a submachine gun, nothing real crazy there. Guns builds are going to be able to use this no problem by the time you're hitting mid-game. You're probably going to have 50 guns or more, assuming you're going with a guns build or a hybrid build. The 10mm SMG does 19 damage per shot, which is decent for a submachine gun. It's not super high, but it's not super low either. This does 171 damage per second. Pretty high, as you would expect from a submachine gun. The submachine guns in this game generally are really good at dealing damage per second. 10mm submachine gun is no exception to that. This one does 19 crit damage, same as its normal damage, pretty normal there. This one has a very low crit chance, like all the automatic weapons, or almost all the automatic weapons, at 0.08. So, very low chance of actually hitting crits. Crits can be useful for any automatic weapon, because that'll just buff up your DPS even higher. But it's not a huge deal if you're not hitting those crits consistently. This only costs 22 action points in VATS, so it's actually pretty good for a VATS build, surprisingly. That's always nice to see. This one has 2.2 spread, so fairly wide spread. This isn't going to be very good at very long ranges. It's going to be best at close and medium range, kind of what you'd expect from a submachine gun. This one holds 30 rounds in it, which is perfectly fine for a submachine gun. You don't necessarily need more than that, but more rounds for an automatic weapon is always better, which this one can get an extended magazine. We'll talk about that once we get to the modded version of this. This one weighs 5 weight, so not super heavy, but also not super light. I guess it depends on what you're comparing it to. Heavier than most pistols, not as heavy as a lot of machine guns, so yeah, somewhere in the middle. And this one has 500 item health, which is also pretty good. Submachine guns and just full auto weapons in general can eat through the item health pretty fast, but 500 health gives you a lot of it, and this gun doesn't chew through ammo so fast that you're going to be breaking it really quick, as well as 10mm submachine guns aren't the most difficult thing to find. And once you have jury rigging, or if you have weapon repair kits, it's not going to be a big deal either. Then basically any submachine gun, or really any pistol, can be used just to fix up this, and that's pretty good. You can also get a couple 10mm submachine guns really early on if you'd like to. You could run to Vault 34, which does have some golden geckos in front of it, but so long as you can take out them, and you can take out the first few ghouls in there, you can get access to a couple submachine guns that are just sitting on shelves. Pick those up, and there you go. You could also get the vault armor while you're there. You don't even need to go all the way through the vault, although there is really good guns at the bottom of that, but it is kind of difficult to go down that far. Just running in and grabbing a submachine gun isn't super difficult, as well as I'm pretty sure that there's one in Boulder City. I think it's found in a bathtub or near a bathtub. Just wander around the city there. There's no enemies around, at least normally. If you make enemies, then there could be. But you could just walk into there, grab the submachine gun right away too, and have a pretty decent little submachine gun for the start. For the pros of the 10mm submachine gun, this one does have really high damage per second, like you would hope for a submachine gun, so that's always good. And it has pretty common ammo. 10mm may not be the easiest to find on like dead bodies and stuff, or on raiders. Sometimes you can find it because they might have this or a 10mm pistol. But most vendors tend to sell it. Even starting vendors can sell 10mm, and usually they sell quite a lot of it. You can usually buy a couple hundred rounds from them, similar to 9mm, so actually finding 10mm isn't such a big deal. The only real con to this weapon is that it's sort of rare to find early on. Like I said, there's a couple locations where you can just run to and grab it right away, but in the early game you might be needing to use like weapon repair kits or talk to people to get it fixed, and that's going to cost you a little bit. Later on it shouldn't be a problem at all, especially if you have jury rigging. Then any handgun can fix this, and you're pretty much set then. Since this does fire the 10mm round, you do have a couple different ammos you can load into it. 10mm doesn't get that many different ammos, though. It has the standard 10mm, which is just the regular 1x damage, no extra effect on it. You have the hollow point rounds, which give you 75% more damage, but it also gives the target 3x the amount of armor. So it's really bad against armored targets, really good against flesh targets. So no armored enemies or very light armored enemies. Hollow points can be great. You just have to buy those, though. The far better and easier one to get, in my opinion, is the jacketed hollow points. You have to get this from the perk hand loader, but this makes it so you get 65% more damage rather than the 75% that the regular hollow points give, but you can convert regular bullets into these, and it gives the enemy double the amount of armor. Still not very good against medium and heavy armored enemies because they can tank through this. You don't do that much damage per shot, so heavy armored enemies, it can be a little bit rough to use on, but medium armored enemies you can get away with, and light armored enemies you can absolutely get away with. And of course, non-armored enemies, it's incredibly strong to use these. There are a couple of perks that can kind of help with the 10mm submachine gun as well. Let's talk about them now. There's nothing that's super in particular for this. It's not like the 9mm submachine gun that had grunt. This one doesn't get a bonus from actually using grunt, which is kind of interesting. I figured it might, since you do see 10mm submachine guns, at least in like Fallout 3, being used by the military. But you know, different game, different part of the world, so grunt doesn't affect it. Running gun can be kind of useful for this one, just because it makes it more accurate when you're actually running. That's okay if you want to be using this at kind of medium range. Still not going to be great at long range. And you could also take the professional with this, since this is a one-handed gun. You do get extra crit chance with it, so that can be kind of, well, not necessarily extra crit chance, extra crit damage. So when you are hitting those kind of inconsistent crits, you can potentially get some more damage from it, which can be good. For an overall rating for the 10mm SMG, I think I'd put it up into B tier. It's pretty good. Pretty much all the submachine guns in this game are good, though. They can all work really well at most ranges and against most enemies. And usually the only thing that's kind of holding you back for using the submachine gun is the amount of ammo that you have. If you have a lot of ammo, no problem. If you don't have very much ammo, can be a problem. Let's talk about the modded version of the 10mm submachine gun, which you can also just make in the game because this does change it up a little bit. The 10mm submachine gun gets access to two mods. These mods are the compensator and the extended magazine. The extended magazine is super straightforward. It just increases your magazine size from 30 to 40, so you get 10 more shots. That's good. Full auto weapons love a larger magazine size, and this comes at no detriment. So if you find an extended mag, fantastic. And then the compensator increases your accuracy. It actually increases it quite a bit. It goes from 2.2 spread to 1.2 spread. So it's actually one of the most accurate submachine guns then. It's still not super accurate by like rifle standards. It's not going to be way great at very long range. But at close and medium range, especially medium range, it's going to feel really, really consistent. This doesn't change the submachine gun dramatically, but it does help with it. And I would put the modded version also up into B tier, but much higher. Maybe even up into A tier. It could go up there. It's really good for just clearing up smaller things. And it can be really good for like picking off Kazdors, picking off all the submachine gun things that submachine guns love to pick off. There's also one unique version of the 10mm submachine gun that we need to talk about. And this one is a lot of people's favorite, or one of their favorite guns, one of their favorite, like, pistol-type guns, funny enough, because you can't actually sneak this one in. This one is called Sleepy Time. Sleepy Time is a Gunrunner's Arsenal exclusive weapon, so you do need to have that DLC, as well as you do need to buy this from the Gunrunners, and it's going to cost you a pretty penny. Side note, this one probably should have been given to Mr. Holdout on the Strip. I think that would have fit his store far better, but it's not. You just have to buy it from the Gunrunner, sadly. Missed opportunity there, Obsidian. Sleepy Time requires 50 guns and 5 strength, same as the regular 10mm. This one does 22 damage per shot, which is pretty good. 220 damage per second, very good, as you would kind of hope for a submachine gun. Has 22 crit damage, so same as regular damage. A much higher crit chance, but it's still pretty low at 0.1 times, so you at least have a little bit higher chance of critting. It's not super high, but a little bit better. It costs 22 action points, so it's still good in a VATS build. This one has better spread than the regular 10mm submachine gun at 1.7, but it is still more spread than the one with the compensator on it. So if you have the modded 10mm submachine gun, that one's going to be more accurate, but Sleepy Time is more accurate than at least the base 10mm. This one holds 40 rounds into it by default, so it has the extended mag already on it, weighs 5 weight, and has 500 item health just like the regular one. There is two unique things about Sleepy Time though. One is that this is a silent weapon because it has a suppressor already added onto it as well, which is pretty awesome. And two, it is the only submachine gun that is actually an improved holdout weapon. So if you do have 50 sneak, you can sneak Sleepy Time into like casinos and any holdout areas. And it is a very, very strong weapon in those type of situations because most enemies in those type of situations are not going to have the best weapons in the game. They're not going to have like high-powered shotguns, high-powered rifles and stuff. They're generally going to be carrying around like pistols or melee weapons. And you can sneak in a lot of really, really strong melee weapons, and there is some other really strong weapons you can sneak into, like the sawed-off shotgun. But Sleepy Time has one of the highest damage per second, and if you load this with the jacketed hollow points or just with the regular hollow points, you're going to be shredding through just about anything in any of those areas, and it is very, very effective. It's probably one of the best ones to sneak into those areas. But those areas don't come up super often. And when they do, you could argue that maybe you wouldn't even need sleepy time for the area, depending on what you're doing there. Especially if you're doing kind of a pacifist run or just a high speech run. Sleepy time, I would put higher than the regular 10mm submachine gun. I'd probably put this up into A tier. I don't think I'd quite put it up into S tier, because it still, in my opinion, kind of gets beat out by at least two of the other submachine guns in terms of damage per second. To where it's still really good, and I could see people arguing this to S tier. Like I said, this is people's favorite weapon. As a sneak-in weapon, it probably is an S tier sneak-in weapon, because there's just not a whole lot of competition for it. I mean, there's like this, the double barrel, and then basically it's like melee and unarmed weapons, and then some of the pistols, like a light shining in darkness and some other ones. But this is still a very, very good submachine gun, so I would totally understand people putting it up into S tier. It's really good. Today we're going to be taking a look at the HNH nail gun. This is a tool, I guess, it's been repurposed into a weapon that you can find and use in New Vegas. This one is exclusive to the Divide, so you do need the Lonesome Road DLC. And this one you can actually find in a couple of locations where you normally don't find weapons. These can be found in toolboxes around the Divide pretty commonly too. There is a couple mods that I've played around with too that I've added them to the Mojave, where they can show up in toolboxes there as well. And it kind of makes the game even easier than it already is. Not necessarily because the nail gun is super strong, but the nail guns are very pricey. So you can sell them for a lot of caps early on, which is really, really cool. The nail gun, like I said, can only be found in the Divide. Although luckily, since it is in the Divide, you can run and get it super early on, which can be very, very useful because it does take a very common ammo, and vendors tend to actually sell a lot of the ammo that he uses. For the stats of the nail gun, this one requires 75 guns to use, which is rather interesting. It's a lot of guns and only 2 strength, not too surprising in the strength. That will be kind of difficult if you just plan on running and getting this early on, at least to get the guns up, but the strength is pretty manageable by basically everybody. This one does 9 damage per shot, which is okay. I mean, this is a submachine gun. It shoots fairly fast, so it doesn't really need to have high damage. It does 126 damage per second, so that's quite good. This deals 9 crit damage, same as its regular damage. That's pretty normal for most weapons. This has a below average crit chance at 0.12, which is kind of higher than some submachine guns, but it's still very low compared to other weapons. You're not going to be hitting crits super often with the nail gun, but it's okay enough. This costs 20 action points to use in VATS, which is fairly low. That's actually really nice for a submachine gun, so VATS attacks are pretty useful with this. This has 1.4 spread, so okay spread for a submachine gun. It's not super accurate, but it's not super inaccurate either. It'll work just fine for medium and close range. This holds 90 rounds in it by default, or I guess 90 nails. Calling them rounds is a little bit weird, but 90. This weighs 4 weight, so it's fairly lightweight for a submachine gun. And this one has 550 item health, which isn't really the highest for a submachine gun. These can break kind of fast, especially since you are going to be probably spraying these out at enemies as you go. And you may not even want to break these. Like I said, these are kind of pricey, so you can sell them for a decent amount of money. For the general pros of the nail gun, this one does pretty good damage per second. This one also has very cheap ammo. We'll talk about the ammo in just a second. And this one has a pretty low action point cost for a submachine gun, so you can use it in VATS fairly well. For the cons of this weapon, though, it does have limited ammo. It only uses the nail guns. There is no other ammo variation that you can put into the weapon. However, the nails are still pretty decent, though, but it is just something to consider. And there is no unique variant of the nail gun. There is only just regular nail guns. So if you're hoping for some unique colored nail gun, you're going to have to find mods for that. And speaking of ammo, the nails are kind of unique in two ways, because they always have damage threshold breaking on them, so they have armor piercing regardless. Nails do 1x damage normally, but they have -5 damage threshold. So you can punch through some lighter armored enemies, or hurt, I guess, medium armored enemies. This isn't going to hurt heavy armored enemies as much, but it will still do more than what standard rounds normally would from other guns. So that's really nice. The other big advantage the nails give you is that you can make them whenever you would like, because all you need is scrap metal to make them at the workbench, and you can make a decent amount of them. So scrap metal is probably one of the easiest junk items to find. It goes to a lot of different recipes, and making them into nails can work in your favor early on, because again, you can run to the Divide right away, grab a nail gun, run back to the Mojave, and then just make a bunch of nails for this and have a pretty decent early game submachine gun. It's actually really good for crippling limbs too, just like most submachine guns are. I found that it was actually really easy to take this up above good springs and just spray down Cazadors with it, and you can break their wings super quick. And that's actually a pretty decent strategy. That's something I usually do early on in my New Vegas runs anyway, with the 9mm SMG that you find in Doc's house. But if you were to grab that and then also grab the nail gun from the Divide and head on back up there, It's going to be a lot easier if you want to go up there to get Chance's knife, if you want to loot the tribe village there, which can have like fire axes, which are great melee weapons, and if you want to head on further north up to like that little town with the raiders that you can get a trail carbine, some reinforced metal armor, and love and hate. That's not a bad idea to grab this and grab that 9mm and just head on through there. It'll be a lot easier in that case and a lot more manageable. Beyond that, there's not really a whole lot to talk about with the nail gun because there's no perks in particular that actually help with the nail gun besides just the regular gun perks. Something like Bloody Mess helps it with just damage. Running Gun could help it with better accuracy if you really care about that. Aside from that, it's basically all the other perks that just help out your person. So for an overall rating for the Nail Gun, I think I would put this into the C tier of submachine guns. I don't think this is a bad gun by any means, but it is a gun that you kind of have to build around. It feels similar to like the Silent 22 submachine gun, where I like it a lot. It's actually a super fun weapon. I just don't think it's as practical as some of the other submachine guns to use. Maybe this one's a little bit more practical because you can get more nails for it, and the nails do have armor piercing on it, so they're not bad in the early game. But if you just plan on going to like Lonesome Road into the later game, you're probably not even going to use it because you could get better submachine guns like the 12.7mm or the 45. You could also get, I guess, Sleepy Time or Vance's SMG that would probably be better than this too. But it's not a bad weapon by any means. None of the submachine guns really are. They're all pretty decent. They're similar to like the shotguns where they're all pretty decent. And this one's one of the weaker ones, but it's still not terrible by any means. There is also no mods for the nail gun either, so you can't change it in any way. It's just what the base nail gun is. Today we're going to be talking about the Silent 22 submachine gun. A very interesting submachine gun that is one of only two weapons that uses the 22 caliber round in New Vegas. And it is also one of the few suppressed weapons in New Vegas too. It is also an extremely rare weapon to find in New Vegas. There's only a couple areas where you're gonna find people that have this. You're probably gonna have to buy Silent 22s from people like the Gunrunners. You can get them off the Fiends, but the Fiends have a very low chance of actually having them. The Fiends can have a whole bunch of weird weapons, and this is one of them. For the base stats of the Silent 22, this one requires 50 guns and 2 strength to wield. 50 guns is kind of high, but by the time you're getting into New Vegas itself, you should probably have around 50 guns, assuming that you're using a guns build, so it's not too hard to meet this. The 2 strength requirement is extremely easy to meet, and I'm pretty sure every character can hit this. I mean, every character can, even if you start out with 1 strength. So long as you have something giving you strength, you're going to be able to wield this effectively. Or if you just get the implant, then you're going to go up to that. If you go to Old World Blues, you're going to get the reinforced spine or the spineless, which also gives you +1 or +2 strength. So you're definitely going to be able to wield this weapon with any class, which is pretty nice. This one does 10 damage per shot, very low damage as you'd kind of expect for a 22. Same thing kind of goes with the 22 handgun. However, this one does have 110 damage per second. So the damage per second is really high. Although, if you were to be using this in real life, I believe that the DPS should be much higher and the rate of fire should be much higher. Because I think the gun that this is modeled off of has something like about a 1500 rate of fire. So it should be even higher than this, and that would actually be really cool to see in a game like this. I would like to see this thing have like double the rate of fire. This weapon also does 20 crit damage, which is a little bit unusual. It actually does more damage with crits than with its regular damage, so hitting crits is pretty cool. However, this is a submachine gun, so its crit chance is very low. Its crit chance is 0.23. That's actually a lot higher than other submachine guns, but it's still very low and very inconsistent for hitting crits. Not a huge deal because of the high rate of fire, but building for crits and then building for a submachine gun build doesn't really make a whole lot of sense. This one costs 19 action points to use in VATS, which is pretty low, and this one does fire out in multiple bursts like all the submachine guns do in VATS, so in a VATS build this actually isn't that bad. This one holds 180 rounds in it, unless you get the mod on it. Which I guess we can talk about the mod now because the mod is only for extra ammo. And that makes it so your modded version of your Silent 22 goes up to 240 rounds in it. And I still actually don't think that that's the actual amount of ammo that this gun holds in real life either. I think it's actually like 360 is the normal. Or maybe 240 is the normal and 360 is basically like the larger version of it. So potentially we're even getting shortchanged on the actual amount of ammo you can have in this. Funny enough. This one does weigh 8, so it is pretty hefty. As you would kind of expect, it is a pretty bulky little submachine gun, and this one has 1000 health to it, which is pretty good. Submachine guns and full auto weapons tend to have a lot of health overall, and you kind of need that with the high rate of fire because it can break the weapon fairly quick. For the general pros of this weapon, it does actually have pretty high damage per second, which is nice, and it does have an extremely large magazine. Those are the two major pros of this weapon. It takes a long time to run out of bullets, and it does do pretty good consistent damage towards enemies, so long as they don't have armor. For the general cons of this weapon though, It does do very low damage. The low damage doesn't help against armored enemies. The 22 bullet also doesn't help against armored enemies, and we'll talk about in a second when we get to the actual ammo, because you don't have any armor penetration whatsoever with 22. So it's just whatever we're dealing with. So dealing with something like geckos, or mole rats, or light armored enemies, this one works fantastically well against them. Against things like rad scorpions, or medium armored enemies, or heavy armored enemies, this one will struggle because it can't punch through that armor, and that armor does mitigate the damage quite a bit thanks to it. Besides the ammo and the low damage, there is also the con of this being very rare. You're probably going to buy it, or you're going to have to specifically find it. It is also one of the more difficult weapons to repair, since there aren't very many of them, so weapon repair kits might be necessary, going to vendors that can actually fix them might be necessary, or jury rigging might be necessary, and then you're going to have to buy like service rifles to fix this up with, or something else along those lines. So it is one of the more expensive weapons to actually fix up. It's not impossible to fix up by any means though, so that may or may not be an issue to you. For the ammo of the 22, we actually only have three bullets, which we've talked about before with the pistol. We have the standard 22 bullets, which just give you regular damage across everything, pretty normal. We have hollow point rounds, which get you more damage but give the enemies even more armor. So this one's even better against light armored enemies like geckos and barely armored people. But against heavy armored enemies like, say, giant rad scorpions, yeah, the Silent 22 is not going to be doing basically anything to them. It's going to be doing very, very little. And then you also have the plinking rounds as your third option. Plinking rounds you have to buy in bulk, and these ones make it so you do less damage with the Silent 22, but you also break your weapon slower. So it can be kind of useful, and it can be useful in the early game, as well as 22 bullets kind of have their own issue of being fairly rare for vendors to sell at least a large quantity of them. You're probably going to have to go to like the Great Cons to buy a bunch of them. They tend to sell a decent amount at least. If you plan on running and using just the 22s throughout the game, then grabbing them at Chet's place can be kind of useful because he'll usually sell plinking rounds in bulk. 22s are kind of awkward. So long as you have bullets, they're actually pretty good, but actually finding the bullets is a little bit more rare. So for an overall rating for both the modded version of the submachine gun and the regular submachine gun, I would put this into C tier on our tier list. It is still a submachine gun, its damage per second is still really good, and it can be really, really useful against certain enemy types. Like, it can absolutely shred Cazadors since they don't have armor. You don't need that, you just need a high rate of fire, just spray at the wings and you'll break them no problem. So it does actually have a pretty useful little niche there, but against big enemies, against stronger enemies, enemies that have armor, enemies that have high health pools, the Silent 22s, both the pistol and the submachine gun, kind of fall apart there. I also wish the Silent 22 was a sneak-in weapon. Sadly, it's not. The pistol is, but the submachine gun isn't. And this does have a suppressor on it, too. I probably should have included that with the cons. Or the pros, sorry, not the cons. The suppressor just makes it so that it's less likely for enemies to find you once you're spraying at them. That can be kind of useful with the submachine gun, but it's also not the most useful. It's not as useful as, like, a sniper rifle with a suppressor on it, since you're probably going to be further away. The submachine gun, you're probably going to be a whole lot closer just so that you can hit more shots. So would I recommend the Silent 22 submachine gun in Fallout New Vegas? Yes and no. I really like the look of it. By the time you're actually getting to the Silent submachine gun, though, probably not, because you could have already gotten 10mm submachine guns and 9mm submachine guns, and those ones are generally going to be better, as well as the ammo is just way more common for those. So you're probably going to be able to use them a lot more often. And since you're in New Vegas, you could have also gotten something like Vance's submachine gun. Vance's submachine gun is a whole lot better, but if you just really like the look of it and you really want a 22 gun, then the Silent 22 submachine gun can be pretty useful. Hello and welcome back to the Wasteland, everybody. Welcome back to New Vegas, where today we're going to be taking a look at the Tommy gun, a very, very, very iconic weapon in, well, really any game series and just in the world and in Fallout. The Tommy gun has appeared multiple times throughout the Fallout games, appearing in Fallout New Vegas, Fallout 4, and Fallout Tactics, I believe. So that's pretty cool. I think it's also in 76, but I could be wrong because I haven't played 76 still. This is the 45 SMG that you find in Zion. You can find this as soon as you get to Zion if you're doing the Honest Hearts DLC, and you can buy this right from Joshua. You can also find this on White Legs because this is like their signature weapon. So that's pretty cool too. The 45 SMG requires 75 guns in order to wield and 6 strength. A lot of guns and a decent amount of strength for a submachine gun. It is warranted for this particular weapon, though, and that should be about the normal amount of strength that gun builds are going for, and the guns is pretty common, too, by the time you're getting to Zion, I would think, unless you're just rushing right there, which I do know some people do that because you can get, like, this, the Survivalist Rifle, the Desert Ranger Armor, and all of those are really good starting items. for any sort of playthrough. This one does 26 damage per shot, which is very high for a submachine gun. That's actually really good. This one does 286 damage per second. However, that damage per second can jump up immensely with the different mods and with the different perks that you can have. It can like easily double. So DPS is extremely high on the 45 SMG. This one does 26 crit damage, which is still pretty decent. It's the same as its regular damage. Nothing real weird there about this. Most guns actually have something like this. This one has a 0.06 times crit modifier. So very low, like most full auto weapons. And crits are extra damage, so that's always good. And this is just a way to balance it out so that they're not hitting crits way too often and being really overpowered. For some reason, the Tommy gun only requires 19 action points to use, which I always find is weird. I would figure it would cost more than other submachine guns, but this is one of like the best submachine guns to be using in VATS, and it's a little bit strange for that. This one has wide spread compared to the other submachine guns at 2.3, so that is quite a bit. Sometimes the rounds don't go exactly where you want them to. If you're only going to be using this at close and medium range, that shouldn't be too big of a deal, but at longer ranges, you will notice your bullets just kind of going everywhere. So keep that in mind when you're using the Tommy gun. This has a 30-round stick mag in it. I say that because this does actually have a drum mag that you can put on it as a mod, and that changes the magazine size. I think both look very good on the Tommy gun. I'm more of a fan of the drum mag because it looks more like a Tommy gun then. But yeah, the 30 round mag is perfectly fine too. This one weighs 11 weight. It is the heaviest submachine gun in the entire game, and that does actually weigh you down quite a bit, especially with how quickly you can break these. If you're putting like the super rounds in them, they break pretty fast, and carrying around multiple of these does weigh you down pretty quick. 11 weight is actually enough though to have it get cut in half with heavyweight, which is pretty cool. So it's the only submachine gun that actually benefits from that perk. And this has 600 item HP, which is usually quite a bit for a full auto weapon. It's not one of the most that we've talked about, but it's still fairly high. It's just that if you are going to be loading like the super rounds of this, it does break them really quick. So you do have to remember that. If you're just using the regular 45 rounds, it shouldn't break any quicker than most of the other submachine guns, like the 9mm SMG and the 10mm SMG. For the general pros of the Tommy gun, this one has really high damage per second. It has some of the highest damage per second out of any weapon in the entire game. Basically, the only other submachine gun that can really compete with this, and depending on what type of enemy we're talking about, would be the 12.7mm SMG. And that's about it. The other ones don't really come as close to the 45 SMG. They're not bad, it's just that this one is one of the highest. This one also has really good ammo. The 45 ammo is fantastic. It actually has quite a few options there. It's just it's kind of a pain because you have to go to Zion to unlock the ammo, but the ammo does start showing up on traveling merchants and other merchants once you get back to the Mojave, so it's not such a big deal. And this one has really good action points. It's one of the best VATS submachine guns in the game, so that's really, really cool. The cons, there's only real like two cons to the Tommy gun. One is that it's heavy, it weighs 11, although again you can cut that in half with heavy weight and then it's not that bad, and it kind of eats through ammo. The Tommy gun can shoot pretty fast and it can chew up just about anything in front of it, and it can also chew up all of your ammo, so you will probably want to carry around a decent amount of this. For perks that can help out the Tommy gun, we've already talked about heavyweight. Heavyweight's good because it cuts its weight in half, so it goes from 11 to 5.5 weight. That's pretty decent. That's not that bad for a submachine gun then. Pack rat can also be pretty useful in the same way because you will probably want to be carrying around a lot of 45 rounds, and cutting the weight in half from that, at least if you're playing on the hardcore difficulty, will help. If you're not playing on hardcore, then don't worry about it. And the grunt perk directly affects this one, so it gets 25% more damage if you take the grunt perk, because this is like a military submachine gun. It was the submachine gun of World War II, at least for the US. Assuming it's the same way in the Fallout universe, because that should have still happened the same way in their universe. Either way, it fits for the Tommy gun, and that is really cool. As for the 45 ammo, there is actually four different versions of 45 that you can load in this. You have the standard 45 ACP, which just does regular damage. It's a normal ammo. It's going to be the most common ammo that you find, that vendors sell, or that anybody sells. Some of the other ones are a little bit more rare. You have the high-powered rounds. These are one of the more rarer ones. They do 75% more damage per shot, but give the enemy 3 times the amount of armor. This makes it so if you're not fighting armored enemies, this completely shreds through anything. It's incredibly strong against like Cazadors and stuff. Really, really strong gun then. You also have the plus P rounds. These ones give you 10% more damage per shot, which is pretty good. They punch through 2 armor, which gives you a little bit of armor breaking. That's kind of cool. And they do break your gun 20% faster. Breaking it that much quicker isn't such a big deal, and having that armor breaking is actually pretty nice for the 45, but good luck trying to find enough plus P rounds or buy enough plus P rounds to actually make it kind of worthwhile. if you're gonna do that, it's gonna take you a very, very long time to stock up enough ammo to actually really use that. Then we have the super rounds. The super 45 rounds you can make so long as you have the perk hand loader. These ones give you 30% more damage, punch through 4 armor on targets, which is really good, but they do break your gun 2.5 times faster. So breaking your gun 2.5 times faster is a substantial amount. It does make it so the Tommy gun can break really fast, but it does make it so you can shred through enemies really fast. This is usually the go-to ammo that I put into the Tommy gun, because most of the time I'm going to be using this against high priority dangerous enemies at very close range, because it has a high magazine size and it's also really good at those close quarters. It also has just a really high rate of fire, so you can spray down just about anything with it. And that's why I usually do load up this gun if I'm going to be taking the Tommy gun. For an overall rating for the standard Tommy gun, I think I'd put this one very high up into A tier, bordering on S tier. It is one of the best submachine guns in the entire game. Tommy gun is fantastic. Plus, I mean, it looks really cool too. It's a Tommy gun. One thing to note is the Tommy gun that you're seeing in the footage here is actually from kind of a modded one, so it looks a little bit nicer. The one in the game doesn't look quite this nice, but it still doesn't look terrible. The only kind of problem I have with the Tommy gun, at least in the regular vanilla game, is the way your person kind of holds it, because they wrap their hands around it and you kind of see like their hands somewhat whenever you're ADSing with it. If you're hip firing it, it doesn't really bother me that much, but for some reason that always seemed kind of weird that your person's like hand was just kind of like overextended there. There is also a modified version of the Tommy gun too, which I kind of alluded to earlier. The Tommy gun can have 2 mods. You can also buy these in Zion. Joshua sells them, or once you get back to the Mojave, you can buy them from like the Gunrunners. I think other vendors might have them too, but the Gunrunners always are guaranteed to have them at least once you come back, so you might as well get them there. This one gets the drum mag, so you go from holding 30 rounds in the Tommy gun to holding 50 rounds in the Tommy gun, which I think is the best improvement that the Tommy gun can have. Not just because it looks really cool to have the drum magazine on the Tommy gun, but because 50 rounds on the submachine gun does make it very, very good in close quarters. I love taking this thing to the divide and just fighting tunnelers with it. It's really good for that because you're almost always going to be in very close quarters with any of those type of enemies, and just having more bullets does make me feel better to where I will not need to reload this as often as some of the other submachine guns or other weapons in general. The other thing that you can get is a compensator on this. The compensator does reduce the spread, so you go from 2.3 spread to 1.8 spread, which is actually pretty good for a submachine gun and actually decent for a full auto gun. It's still not going to be way amazing at very long ranges, but at that medium range, it's going to feel really good, and at close range, it's still going to feel really good, where that's probably going to be where you're going to be using the Tommy gun the most anyway. And with these attached to the 45 SMG, I think it does actually get quite a bit better, and I would put this one up into S tier. I think it is one of the best submachine guns in the game, really only rivaled by like the 12.7mm submachine gun, which you could argue is better or worse than the Tommy gun. It's really your call then at that point. It is technically easier to get 12.7 rounds than it is to get 45 rounds, but I mean, one looks like a Tommy gun and one looks like a weird abomination of the P90 and like a Vector. Yeah. So if you're going for style, I would pick the Tommy gun, but I don't hate the 12.7 either. At least it looks like it would be functional for the most part. Anyway, would I recommend the Tommy gun? Absolutely. Tommy gun is really cool if you're going with the guns build. Even if you're not going with the guns build, submachine guns are still really good for close range. And even if you spec'd into this, like not at all, you haven't put any guns in, it's still very powerful at close range just because of the amount of firepower that you have and the amount of lead you can spray out at things. Tell me your thoughts on the Tommy gun down in the comments below. How do you guys enjoy it? This one has been requested quite a bit, which I understand. Basically, all the World War 1/2 guns have been asked for quite a while. Today, we're going to be taking a look at the 12.7mm SMG. This is our last submachine gun to go over in Fallout New Vegas, and this one is arguably the most powerful of the submachine guns. It's also probably going to be the very last submachine gun that you get, since this one is quite rare to find. There are a couple enemies that can have this, like hit squads can have this, the white legs can have this in Zion, and I believe sometimes the marked men can have the 12.7mm submachine gun. So high level enemies, at least once you actually get high level, you do need to be like level 30 or so. And there are a couple locations where you can find this. One of them is very far north in the cave with the Night Stalkers that you get from Red Lucy's quest. The name escapes me at the moment, but it's one of those, and you can find this in a locked area. You can also find some other really strong weapons in that same cave. You can find like a hunting revolver, and you can find a hunting shotgun in there. So if you want to run there early and take on the Night Stalkers, you absolutely can do that. Or if you just want to run through and grab everything, you can also do that. For the stats of the 12.7mm submachine gun, this one requires 100 guns in order to wield, and 6 strength to wield it effectively as well, so very high guns requirement. Pretty high strength requirement for a submachine gun. Although most of the submachine guns sit around this area, I think the only one that's higher is the Tommy gun, which kind of makes sense. But you're probably going to have that by the time you're getting these weapons anyway, or considering these weapons, assuming that you're running a primarily guns build. This one does 36 damage per shot, which is very high for a submachine gun. 324 damage per second, which is extremely high for a submachine gun. That can go even higher with different damaging perks. Something like Bloody Mess could help you out with even more damage on top of this. There is no perk specifically for the 12.7mm submachine gun, similar to the Tommy gun like Grunt, but even so, that's still really high damage and really high damage per second. This one does 36 crit damage, same as its regular damage. Has a low crit chance like most of the automatic weapons at 0.08. Although that is higher than some of the other submachine guns, which is usually 0.06, so slightly higher chance to hit crits. That's pretty cool, I guess. Costs 24 action points to use in VATS, meaning that it's fairly low for a submachine gun in VATS. This has two spreads, so fairly wide, but kind of what you would expect from an automatic weapon like this. Holds 21 rounds in it, so a fairly small magazine, at least by submachine gun standards. All the other submachine guns can hold more shots than this. This can be extended with a mod, which does help it out a little bit. This weighs 5 weight in total, so not too heavy, and it has 500 item health, which is perfectly fine. That's not the most amount of item health out of the submachine guns, but you may not even go through health that quickly with this because the DPS is fairly high. For the pros of the 12.7mm submachine gun, this one does have really high damage and really high damage per second. That is really nice for this particular submachine gun. It has really good action point cost as well, so that's pretty good. And the 12.7mm round is fairly good against most enemies. For the major cons of the 12.7, there's only really like two of them. One is that this weapon is fairly rare. There's not a whole lot of places that you can get it, and you're probably gonna have to buy it, but if you have enough caps, that's not really gonna be that much of a con. And the other con is that it doesn't really have much ammo variety. The 12.7mm only gets three different types of ammo. They're pretty good types of ammo, but it does only have those three. It doesn't have any sort of like armor-piercing rounds, which would make it better against bigger enemies like Deathclaws. That's not to say this can't take out Deathclaws, because it absolutely can. It's just that it doesn't have the armor-piercing capabilities like some other weapons do, so it may struggle against more tanky enemies that have thicker armor. Like I said earlier, there isn't really any perks in particular that help out the 12.7mm submachine gun. There's no grunt, there's no cowboy, there's nothing like that, so basic damage perks and basic quality of life perks really help with the 12.7mm on really any build. Pack Rat can kind of help you out on the hardcore difficulty since it will make it so you can carry more rounds for the 12.7. They're not super heavy, but you can carry more then. And VATS perks can also help out with this if you want to go with a VATS build. So Math Wrath or Action Boy and Action Girl can really help out here too. If you just want to be using this more in VATS, that can also be pretty nice. For the different ammos, we have three in total, and only three for the 12.7mm. You have the standard 12.7, which just give you regular damage threshold, all the things that you would kind of expect from most of the normal rounds. These ones would be the best to use against armored enemies, and they're probably going to be the most common rounds that you find. You can actually buy a lot of these from like the Great Con vendor. Sometimes the Gunrunners can sell a decent amount of these. Some other vendors can sell these as well, but I find that the Great Cons tend to have the most of them, so usually I just reset if I need more 12.7mm from them. Just wait like 3 days and you'll be able to get more. But then you also have the hollow point rounds. Good against soft targets, bad against heavy armor. Just like all the hollow point rounds, you get more damage, but enemies get more armor, so it could be worse in certain situations, could be better in others. Really good against Cazadors. And then you have the unique rounds that you can make, which are the jacketed hollow points. These ones are basically the same as the 9mm jacketed hollow points. You get these from the perk hand loader, and then you can make these at a reloading bench where these ones give you more damage, but they also give the enemy more armor. Not nearly as much as hollow points, which is three times the amount of armor. This only gives two times the amount of armor. It doesn't give you the 75% more damage though, like regular hollow points. This one only gives you 65, but that's still quite high, and these are going to be much easier to make because you can just make them from the standard rounds. So if you have an excess amount of them, you can make them into this, and that's usually what I do for the submachine gun. And most of the time, I'll just be using this against enemies that aren't the tankiest, but again, if you want to be using these like against Deathclaws and against Rat Scorpions, you absolutely can. You can be pretty strong against most enemies, maybe really heavy armored enemies like the Brotherhood this wouldn't be the best against, but that's not a real common enemy type anyway in the Mojave, so even then the 12.7 still shines pretty well. For an overall rating for the 12.7mm submachine gun, I see no reason not to put this up into S tier. It's a pretty good submachine gun, it has really high damage per second, it does basically everything that you'd want for a submachine gun, works really well at close range, works really well against soft body targets, doesn't do the best against armor targets, but it's really solid. There is a modified version of this that you can also get, since there is a Gunrunner's Arsenal version of this, and you do need to have that if you want to put mods on it. Just like all the versions of the Gunrunner's Arsenal weapons, this doesn't actually change the base stats of the weapon whatsoever. It just makes it so that it can't accept mods for the Gunrunner's Arsenal DLC. and this gets 3 mods. You can have a laser sight. This decreases the amount of spread that you have, so you go from 2 spread to 1.6 spread. That's pretty good. That makes it more accurate, and it's one of the more accurate submachine guns then. You can have the stacked magazines. Stacked magazines increase your overall ammunition from 21 rounds to 27 rounds. Still kind of a weird amount of ammo that this one holds, but that is better, and it makes it closer to the more standard, like, 30 rounds that most of the submachine guns have, like the 10mm and the 9mm, and the 45. Still always going to have the least amount of ammo overall, but it does help a little bit, and I would say that's probably the biggest buff to this. And then the very last upgrade that you can get is a suppressor, which silences the weapon, so it makes it easier to sneak around and use this. That's pretty strong, but this doesn't necessarily increase the 12.7mm that much more. I mean, I would say the 12.7mm is already an S tier, so the modified version would just go a little bit higher into S tier. It's all around just a little bit better. And I do like the aesthetic of it more, and I do like the sound of it more when it is fully modded, even though this gun does look very strange since it's like a combination of a Vector and a P90, and it's just kind of weird, but I don't really hate it. At least it looks like something that could potentially function in the world. So would I recommend the 12.7mm SMG? Sure, it's pretty strong, it works pretty well. So long as you like the round and you're not fighting super heavily armored enemies with like the hollow point rounds, you should be pretty good. Tell me your thoughts on the 12.7mm down in the comments below. I'd love to hear that. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Have a great rest of your day, and I'll talk to you next time. Bye-bye!